welcome, gentlemen. Thank you. It's lovely to be here. I was really aware coming down, or coming across from Kinsale today, we're standing in this gallery on the edge of a country that's on the edge of Europe and also on the edge of the Atlantic Ocean. And today, there's a weather warning for sleet and snow, horrible things coming. And we're protected by our clothes and our boots and by the walls of this building and also by the sweep of Skibbereen Town itself as it sheltered us from the elements. But that also made me very aware of how hugely on the edge we are. And it was thinking about this and being here that gives rise to that thought that it's not just about being geographically on the edge in Skibbereen. It's about a place and time where we have to think more about our relationship to nature and to culture and that balance of on the edgeness if we're going to be able to sustain into the future. Because culture comes out of nature, it's a reaction to it and a working with it. And we've created it over thousands and thousands of years. And as our sciences and technologies have got more advanced, we've been able to increasingly ignore the nature part and the working with part until now, where nature threatens to remind us that it actually holds all the cards. And it is one of the major issues of our times. And in thinking about this and the work of these three very different artists in two very different exhibitions, I was really fascinated to find this common thread. And of course, that's not the whole story, but I do think it emerges. In Geraldine's Lightkeepers, I'm struck by that fragile balance between the rock and the stone and the sea, and that tenacious persistence of humanity, and also the evocative sense she brings and the emotional sense of those lives lived at the very edge, spent guiding travelers safely home. And do stop and watch the video or come back and watch the video, because you can find wonderful histories through it. You can also find those histories in the lifescape collages she's made, which collect and collage elements of those stories of a dying way of life. And speaking to those who remember working in the lighthouses before automation, although if this exhibition or when it gives you a passion for all things lighthouse, I would also urge you to look up the Irish Landmark Trust, where you can stay in lighthouse keepers' cottages, which isn't quite the same as revering the lives of lighthouse keepers, but they are very wonderful. And wonderful as they are, the very best one is at Wicklow Head, where you actually stay in the tower. And I remember staying there a few years ago in an incredible storm and feeling I could have been at any place at any time, and taking great comfort from knowing that the lighthouse had stood since 1781 and it was probably going to survive another night. And then waking up the next morning in a thick mist, and it just added to this sense of otherworldliness. One of the Landmark Trust lighthouse keepers' cottages is Galley Head, and you can find Geraldine's paintings of the lighthouse at Galley Head here. There's bird's eye view of Galley Head, which I think particularly gives a brilliant sense of that hard-won peace created by our culture against the wild jaggedness of the rocks and the raging seas below. And then when it comes to raging seas, finding the storm at the end here is something to get truly lost in and be thankful that for the walls that surround us. But I do want to be aware that looking for narratives can distort what we see at the same time as it's how our minds understand things. So I'm very conscious of not imposing ideas onto the work, but also aware that there is this shared sense in both exhibitions and all three artists' work of that pull between wild nature and the walls we build up for ourselves to keep safe, both physically and emotionally. And that's something that Anne Ffrench calls rewilding, or getting back to it is what Anne calls rewilding. And as Anne said, Anne and Julia have shared residencies here, so it's less of a surprise that their work has some common concerns Julia both live quite near me in Kinsale, and it's also one of those rural, on the edge but rendered safe through culture places, where we've made somewhere habitable through settlement and building. But Anne, I think, in her work is reaching back to a much deeper culture, which became evident to her, or inescapable to her, through the experience of having two children. And that's that idea of how your body takes over and something very, very primal starts to happen, but which is overlaid with science and medicine, which are very wonderful things because they keep us alive and a third of women no longer die in childbirth, which is great. But you often then forget to remember the very deeper connections, which can be very dislocating. And so in one of the videos, we have a hawk, which is an incredible animal that can be tamed, but never really tamed. So you can come to an accommodation with a hawk, so long as you never forget that at heart it is a truly wild thing. And I think it would be lovely to remember occasionally that about ourselves and forgive in ourselves those impulses when we're at war with that inner wild thing. In Anne's video, you get that sense of barely contained nature within the hawk and that utter wildness, even though it's sitting patiently watching on the perch over these eggs, which, by the way, are made of breast milk. And instead of hatching to make new lives, they're melting back into a hollow in the table and seeming to restore it to perfect domesticity. Although you also know if you were able to give it a nudge, it would be revealed to be fragile after all. And I think in the past, we've made sense of these contradictions between nature and culture through ritual. And we'll see it coming up soon in some of the iconography of the St. Patrick's Day parades. And then recently again in the pieces we make to celebrate Lough Fela Breida. And I do think that sometimes art and imagery are the best way to touch on them, because language is a very ill-fitting lid to try and cover what's in the world and in our minds. So I'm also very conscious when talking about the exhibitions that I don't want to say this means this or that lemon in Anne's work represents that, but also I would love you to think, when you look at the lemons, about the idea of decay, the life cycle of the natural, timelessness of art, the idea of something sort of casual and throwaway made into something precious and other. It's all in there. But what I would like to get you to think about is let the seeming strangeness seep in so that maybe that connection to something older can start to take hold of your thinking. And Julia's done this brilliantly in taking those gate ornaments you see, whether they're elves or puppy dogs, when you're driving across rural Ireland. And I really enjoyed spotting loads on my way over. There was, I think, horses slightly outnumbered elves, but it was a close run thing. And she's first of all reminding us to see them. And it was only through thinking about her work that I started to notice them again. And then she plays with the idea through those three colours she has, because if those animals are protecting the houses, why can't we have some for ourselves? And for all of you who read Philip Pullman's Dark Materials trilogy, where the children have demons which they speak to and relate to, or in other cultures, the spirit animals that other ways of thinking allow us to acknowledge or have walk with us. And Julia takes it further. She doesn't just give us back our spirit animals, but she allows the houses themselves to have an interior life. So she'll have them clad in feathers, giving them a dream of flight, or replacing foundations with roots, which remind me that even after I've retreated from the world to the safe solitude of my house, and who hasn't felt that way from time to time when they close the door behind them, that we're still actually connected to the world and to land and to nature and to the consequences of our actions. And so if your house does have an interior life, what might it be thinking or dreaming? Or has it just accumulated the resonances of thoughts and dreams over the years? And then the spirit animals, are they nature looking to connect with us or something else again? And do go upstairs and take a look at the window of them, outside the window of them, lined up at the roof, watching us back in. Oh, and I saw them, I thought,